number of weeks ago when I began speaking here on Sunday evenings about the miracles that Jesus did recorded for us in the book of John. I'd said at that time there were seven such miracles recorded here in the first half of the book of John, and this is number seven. So we've come to the end of that here. And yet, this one final miracle we see here recorded by John is one of the most marvelous events in all of the New Testament. And in this account that's given to us here in John chapter 11, we see a number of things there. We see sickness, we see sorrow, we see death, and we also see something of the compassion and the power that our Lord had. And so tonight we want to look at not just these few verses that were read for us, but considering the whole chapter from chapter 1 through verse 44, to look at these verses and notice the number of lessons we might be able to learn and profit by it. But I want to begin by, first of all, just noticing four different parts of this as we look through it and discuss about this. And the first part I want us to notice is the call to Jesus. And I think this is one of the more unique things, but it's something, I believe, of great importance, at least from my standpoint, because as I was studying through this, I learned something about this, recognized something about it that I'd never noticed before, that I think is important to those of us who are children of God. When Lazarus was first stricken, he was there at his home in Bethany. Now, there are two different cities in the Bible named Bethany. There's Bethany beyond the Jordan, over on the eastern side of the Jordan River. But then there's the Bethany here where Mary, Martha, and their brother Lazarus lived. And it's a little bit less than 2 miles from Jerusalem. And this is a place that Jesus was familiar with. So many times when he was in Jerusalem teaching and preaching, he might withdraw from there and go off to Bethany to find rest. And many times he could find that rest in the homes of these of his friends. But at this time that Lazarus is there in Bethany and he's stricken with sickness, Jesus is over on the other side of the Jordan River. He's on the eastern side in Perea. Exactly where there, we don't know, but at least a day's journey from there that Jesus is gone. And the Bible tells us that when Lazarus became ill, that his sisters, Martha and Mary, immediately sent word to Jesus. And it's interesting to me to notice that and the way they requested of Jesus about their brother's sickness as compared to what other people have done. We've noticed a number of miracles that Jesus did. And when you look at it, there was the official whose son was sick. And he came to Jesus and pled with Jesus that Jesus would heal his son, come heal his son. And Jesus said that you come down before he dies. So there's a direct request for the healing for his son. But more than that, there's the desire that he has that Jesus would come quickly to that, lest his son die before Jesus could get to him. And then we think about Jairus' daughter. Jairus had come also when his daughter was ill with a request that Jesus would come down and heal his daughter. Then the Syrophoenician woman who had a daughter that was possessed of demons, and she came to Jesus and made that request that Jesus would come down and heal her daughter. And then there was blind Bartimaeus. We talked about him a little bit as we discussed other blind men. The one born blind was healed by Jesus. Bartimaeus was a blind man, and he was the son of a blind man. And he's the one that when Jesus came through Jericho had made such a racket crying out to Jesus, "Lord, have mercy on me." And the people tried to get him to be quiet, and the more they tried to get him to be quiet, the louder he yelled. And finally, Jesus stopped. And Jesus said, "Bring him to me." And so they brought Bartimaeus to him. And Jesus had a request, "What do you want me to do for you?" And he said that I might see. Now I point out each of these and so many others of the miracles that Jesus did is because the people had a specific request of Jesus, that something they wanted him to do, and some of them wanted him to do that immediately. But when you look here about Mary and Martha, when their brother is sick and they send a messenger to Jesus about it, the message they send to Jesus is a simple one: "Lord, he whom you lovest is sick." There's no plea on their part for Jesus to come down quickly, and there's no plea on their part that he would heal Jesus. And that strikes me as so different from what we see in these other things, and wonder, what was this all about? I believe that as far as Mary and Martha was concerned, it was sufficient just to let Jesus know that the one that he loved was sick. And they're going to leave it up to Jesus, "You'll do what's best." Isn't that what we're supposed to do when we pray our prayers to God, and if we pray for those who are sick, that Jesus has taught us that when you pray, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done." And I think in essence, that's what they're doing when they offer this prayer. When they say, "Lord, him whom you love is sick," let him know about it, and then leave it up to Jesus to do what is right. They have that faith and confidence that whatever needs to be done, the will of God will be done by Jesus. So let him know the problem, the sickness of Lazarus, and leave it up to him then to do what needs to be done. That's not unlike an event you have in the Old Testament when King Hezekiah finds himself being threatened by Sennacherib. Sennacherib has come down. He has a great army. He is the king of Assyria. And they're an army that's been successful in defeating a number of nations. And they come down against Jerusalem. And the message that they give through the Rabshakeh, that they give to Hezekiah, is that he needs to surrender. And if you will just give up, surrender yourself to us, then we will take you to another place, another land to dwell, a land much like what you have here, and everything will be well with you. But if you resist, we're going to destroy you, and you will be put to death. And so faced with that, Hezekiah then goes to God. But when the Bible talks about it in the book of 2 Kings in chapter 19, the Bible says that Hezekiah took the letter that had been brought to him from that wicked king Sennacherib, and he took the letter to the temple, and the text says simply he laid it out before God. In other words, God, here's the problem. Here's what this man is doing, threatening us, and what he's going to do to us, and letting us know what he's done to these other nations, and none of the gods of those other nations were able to help them. Now here it is, God, here's the problem. And there's no request being made there, Lord, destroy this man and his army, lest he do harm for us. He's just letting God know the problem with the confidence and trust that God will do what's right. God's will be done. And that's the way it is when I see Mary and Martha here. Lord, him whom you lovest is sick. Trusting in Jesus that he will do right. And so the call that they make to him, to me, it's different from what we see in the other instances of the miracles that Jesus did. Number two, the delay. After Jesus receives word that the one he loves is sick, the Bible says that he waited 2 days before leaving. And people have often wondered why. What was the purpose behind that? Why would Jesus wait 2 days? And if you look among scholars, it seems like the majority of them say, well, the reason he waited 2 days was making sure, you know, that Lazarus has died. And then when Jesus comes to resurrect him, that's going to have a far greater effect on the people than if he just simply came and healed somebody that was sick. And so to make sure that he's dead, we're going to wait 2 days before going. Some people think maybe Jesus did this because he doesn't really love them like you would think he loves them. But that can't be the case, because the Bible makes it very clear in verse 5 that Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. And so he didn't delay simply because he doesn't care, is not concerned about them. He wanted them to know that, and he loved them. Well, why did he delay 2 days? Why wait for that? Well, is it because he wanted to make sure that Lazarus was dead before he came? You know, when Jesus does come there, and he talks with them, and he goes out to the gravesite, and he gives the command for them to remove the stone, you remember what Martha's reaction was initially? Lord, by now he stinketh, for he's been dead for 4 days. Now, where Jesus is at is a day's journey from Bethany. So they had to journey 1 day to get to Jesus. He waits 2 days, and then it's going to take another day's journey to get there. And when he gets there, Martha says he's already been dead 4 days. That means in all likelihood, Lazarus was dead before those messengers ever got to Jesus. He doesn't have to wait another 2 days. You know, he's already dead when the messengers come. And if he had just left immediately, it would have taken him a day's journey to get there, then he would have been dead already 2 days. So he doesn't have to wait that time in order that the man might surely be understood to be dead. So why wait that 2 days at all? Well, we know among other things that this was done for the glory of God. You remember last week, we talked about the man that was born blind. And the disciples had asked Jesus, Lord, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he should be born blind? And Jesus says, neither this man nor his parents have sinned, but this is for the glory of God. And so it is with Lazarus. You know, what's going to happen, waiting that 2 days and waiting until he gets there and Lazarus has already been dead and buried for 4 days, and by now his body has begun to decay, then it's going to be obvious to everybody that a real miracle, unlike any other thing they've ever seen before, is taking place.
And this will be for the glory of God. God's going to be glorified. It's not for the benefit only of Lazarus or his sisters, but this is so that God himself would be glorified in this event. And so he delays 2 days. And then notice thirdly, Jesus with the mourners. What it's like when Jesus gets there. When he comes, he's first of all met by Martha. And she comes out to Jesus, and the first words out of her mouth are, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." So he talks to Martha, and he explains to Martha, "Your brother will live again." And she says, "Lord, I know he's going to live again in the day of the resurrection." And Jesus said, "Martha, I am the resurrection and the life." And Jesus explains to her about that. And he asked her the question, "Martha, do you believe this?" And Martha said, "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then she leaves Jesus and goes to her sister Mary. And she comes to Mary and she says, "Mary, the Master has come and he's asked for you." So Mary goes out to meet Jesus. And when she comes to Jesus, she falls down at his feet. And the first words out of her mouth are the very same words Martha spoke. She says to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Now, for years, when I've read that and thought about that, I thought that both Martha and Mary were being somewhat contentious with Jesus, upset with him and his failure to act properly. "Lord, if you had come, our brother wouldn't have died." I mean, I can understand that someone might have been upset. Here's one that certainly has the power to heal. It's someone that loves Lazarus, who's ill. So, "Lord, if you'd just come, we wouldn't be going through this now." But obviously, I don't believe that they're angry at Jesus for his failure to come promptly. But I think what's happening to him now, as I look at this, is that they're simply going through and experiencing what so many of us experience in life when bad things happen to us in life, and we can't understand why. And sometimes we have this "if." And sometimes I believe that we terrorize ourselves with that word "if." If this had happened, if that had happened, the difference it would have made. Several years ago, and I'm not sure whether it was in one of his gospel meetings at Old Woodlawn or at one or two of the other places where I'd heard Brother Jimmy Allen preach, or whether it's in one of the two classes I had with him at Harding University. But Jimmy Allen was talking one time about his mother's death. His mother's death was unexpected. She was killed in a train car accident. She was in an automobile with 3 other women. 3 of the women survived. 1 died, his mother. 2 of the women had acted very quickly and got out of the car, and they were safe. 1 of the other women was very slow at acting, and she never got out of the car, and she was safe. But Jimmy's mother was a little bit slower than the first 2 women, but a little bit faster than the last woman. She was halfway out of the car when the train hit it, and she's the only one that died. And Jimmy Allen said, "You cannot imagine how many times I said to myself and cried to myself, even when I'd go and visit her gravesite, that I would stand over her grave, and over again I was thinking, if she had been a little bit faster, she'd still be with me. Or if she had been a little bit slower, she'd still be with me." But you can if yourself to death, Jimmy said, and it's not going to change anything. It's something we have a tendency to do. We punish ourselves many times with that idea, if. And that may have been simply all that's going on here with Martha and Mary. They're going through that over and over again in their mind. If this had happened, if that had happened, our brother would still be alive. But notice the attitude that Jesus had toward the event here. Number one, Jesus recognized the reality of death and the bereavement that comes with it. He knows what they're going through. He understands that death is a reality. We can't avoid that. It's going to come in the life of everyone. Every one of us is going to die. Those that we love are going to die. And there are going to be those times in life when you're going to have to experience the death of someone you love and care about. And there's going to be tremendous sorrow in your life because of that. It's a reality of life. And Jesus understood that, and he knew that. And that's why on occasions like this, when people are hurting, when they're in deepest of sorrow, Jesus comes to them. Jesus is not the kind of person to shun sorrow in life. One of the hardest things in being a minister of the gospel are those times when you're called upon to go visit someone who's just lost a loved one and feeling totally inadequate to be able to help and encourage those people. When I lived in Atlanta, that was my first job out of college, one of the men in the congregation there, a young man, a little bit younger than I was, and he was married, and he was in school in Atlanta. He was in the Gupton Jones School of Mortuary Science. His father was a mortician, and he was in school to become a mortician. And there were times I'd get calls from him, and he'd say, "Tim, I want you to come go with me." "Where are we going?" "Got a death call. Got to go pick up a body." "Well, no, I don't think so." "Come on, you need to, you're a minister. You're going to be around people or something. You need to do this." And I said, I really don't want to do that. And I talked with him. I says, I don't think I could ever do a job like you're doing, because you're constantly around people who are in the deepest of sorrow and having lost someone they loved." And he said, "Well, you do the same thing. If you're a preacher, you're going to have to preach funerals." And I said, "Yes, but it's not going to be that often. You're having to do this every day of the week. For the rest of your life, you're going to be dealing with people whose hearts are broken." And I said, "I just find that too difficult to be around." But then you get to think about Jesus. Jesus was constantly around those who were in sorrow, and he never shunned the opportunity to be with those people, to be able to offer some kind of encouragement and help. Long ago, Isaiah had prophesied about the coming of the Messiah in Isaiah 61 verse 1. And then that prophecy says, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound." Christ is sent to those people who are suffering in life, to those whose hearts are broken. But he never turned away from the responsibilities that God gave him. He never left off going to those who were in sorrow to encourage and help them in some way. But also, he never made light of the sorrow that people were undergoing. Sometimes I hear it said, when someone dies, and people are mourning and weeping about that, and sometimes I've heard people say, "Well, listen, you're supposed to be a Christian. You're supposed to believe in Christ and in the resurrection, that the death is not the end of things. We keep on living. And yet here you are weeping and crying like I don't know what." Jesus never did anything like that to people. He understood the sorrow that they were going through, and his desire was to encourage them and help them in their time of sorrow. And even though Jesus knew he was going to resurrect Lazarus in just a few moments, he doesn't say to Martha, "Cut this weeping out. Everything's going to be all right. You ought to know better now. You just got through saying a few moments ago to me that you believe that I am the Christ, the Son of God. You believe that your brother's going to be raised again. So why are you weeping?" He doesn't do that. He doesn't make light of the sorrow and the troubles that people have. But rather, Jesus joined in with them. The shortest verse in the Bible, the verse that everybody memorizes, John 11 and 35, Jesus wept. And when Jesus wept, the Jews were there with Martha and Mary and looked upon them. Their conclusion was, "Behold how he loves them." Jesus felt their sorrow, and he shared in their sorrow on that occasion. He still does the same thing with us. Whenever those sorrows come into your life and you're hurting, you need to understand and realize how much Jesus cares and is concerned for you and how he suffers with you in that sorrow. And so the Hebrew writer said in Hebrews 4, 15 and 16, "For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin." And then he adds, "Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain help and mercy and grace to help in time of need." He still cares. He still is concerned about us. And in our sorrows, Jesus is always there to help us out. And on this occasion, Jesus spoke some wonderful words of consolation to these two sisters. And he talked to them and assured them of Lazarus' resurrection. And he gives to you and I the same assurance today in regard to the resurrection of our loved ones who have died, and even in regard to our own resurrection. That we die, we will be resurrected again. And then finally, to notice here also Jesus at the tomb. When he comes there to the place where Lazarus is buried. Now Jesus has already experienced raising other people from the dead. But this time there's something unique about it. When Jairus' daughter was raised up from the dead, it was shortly after she had died, and she's still there in the home of her father. And Jesus comes in and raises her up from the dead. Or you think about the widow's son, the widow of Nain. He is on the way to be buried. They're just coming out of the city of Nain when Jesus stops that funeral procession and raises that young man up from the dead. But this is different. On this occasion, Lazarus has already been dead for 4 days and his body is already in a sealed tomb. And Jesus comes there to the gravesite. He commands them to remove the stone, and when the stone is moved, Jesus spoke. Not once, but twice. He spoke the first time to the living, and he spoke the second time to the dead. When Jesus spoke to the living, he spoke to the living God. And in his prayer to God on that occasion, he says to him, "Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that you've sent me." Here is a miracle that's going to have a tremendous effect upon people. When they see a man dead 4 days and buried in the grave, is brought forth to life again. And so Jesus speaks to God with this prayer, giving thanks to God for this opportunity and for what's going to happen, that God may be glorified and that men can be brought to faith in God and in Christ. But after he spoke to the living God, he spoke to the dead. Oh, not the dead in general. He spoke to the dead specifically. Brother Marshall Keeble said, "It's a good thing that our Lord said, 'Lazarus, come forth.' For if he had just said, 'Come forth,' everyone in the graves would have come out of the graves. But Jesus speaks specifically to the dead man, Lazarus, and says, 'Come forth.' And he that was dead came forth." Now, this was done not for the benefit of Lazarus. It wasn't done for the sake of his sisters, Martha and Mary. But as we said, it was done for the glory of God. Because this miracle is going to reveal to the people the power of God, and it's going to reveal to them the benevolent purpose of God, the love and care that it has for them. This is to show them that Jesus truly is who he claimed to be when he spoke to Martha and said, "I am the resurrection and the life." And now here's evidence of that fact, that he's brought back to life someone who's been dead for 4 days. One whose body has already begun undergoing decay, and he's brought back to life. So there we have the setting here of it. And now, very quickly, let me just point out two lessons we need to learn from this that I think will benefit us in our lives and will help us in our efforts to be able to live as the way God wants us to live. First of all, let us learn that God loves each of us as individuals. I don't know why that's such a hard thing to get across to people. But when we study with people down in Belize, and I've seen it even here in the U.S., and we're studying with them that little booklet, you know, God Speaks Today, and you get to that last lesson, and you talk about Jesus' death and what he endured, how he was beaten the way he was, and how he was nailed to that cross, and how people had humiliated him and had spoken evil against him over and over again. And asked the question, why would Jesus endure that? And evidently, you know, every time when people speak, they speak in generalities and they say it was because he loved us. And I said, well, can you be more specific than that? And they said, because he loves all of us. Now, that's true, but you need to be more specific than that. Look what happens here. In John chapter 11 and verse 5, the Bible says, "Now Jesus loved the family of Lazarus." No. The Bible says, "Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. And you can add your name to that. And Jesus loves Dennis. And Jesus loves Pat. And Jesus loves Dot. And Jesus loves Tim. We need to understand that God loves you as an individual. We're not just lost in a crowd and a multitude of people that Jesus loves. When Jesus thinks about the love that He had, He's got you in mind. He's thinking about you. And so let's remember and learn this lesson here. Jesus loves Martha, Martha's sister, and Lazarus. And Jesus loves me and you as an individual. But secondly, let us also learn from this that there is going to be that resurrection that Jesus promised. Martha believed in it. She said, "Lord, I know my brother will live again in the resurrection day." You know, that great day that's coming when all men are going to be raised. I believe in that. I know that's going to happen. But Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And Jesus has assured us that there is that time coming when everybody will be resurrected. In the book of John, chapter 5, at verses 28 and 29, Jesus said, "Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming which all that are in the grave shall hear His voice and come forth. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation." There is a day of resurrection coming. And it's not just an individual like Lazarus, but everyone who has ever died that will be brought forth again from the dead. And when we're brought forth, we're going to be brought forth for the judgment to stand before God. And as we said this morning from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we'll have to give an account to God for how we've lived. And so that resurrection is going to be either a resurrection unto life eternal or a resurrection into condemnation and damnation for eternal. What it's going to be for us as individuals is going to be determined by how we live in this life that we have. Those that have done good, those who have been obedient to God and becoming His children. And so many times we talk about it, and I don't like to end any lesson without repeating again what it is that God requires of us in becoming His children, that we believe in Jesus, that we repent of our sins, confess our faith in Christ before men, and we're buried with Christ in baptism for the forgiveness of our sins. And when we do that, not only are sins removed, but God adds us to His family, to His kingdom. We become His children. And as His children, God expects us to live our lives in a faithful obedience to Him. And then when that time of resurrection comes, we will be among those raised up to resurrection of life eternal with God. If you've done that, and you haven't been living faithful to God, you see, God says to that erring child of His, you need to repent of your sins and pray to God that you might be forgiven. That's the very thing that Peter had told Simon the sorcerer, who had believed, had been baptized, but when later he thought he could purchase the gift of the Holy Spirit, Peter said to him, "Thy money perish with thee." He was in a perishing condition, even though he was a child of God. And so Peter told him to repent, therefore, of this thy wickedness, and pray God, perhaps the thoughts of thy heart may be forgiven thee. And not satisfied to simply pray himself, Simon asked Peter and the others to pray with him. And so the church here is willing to do that. If your sin has been of a public nature that it needs to be acknowledged publicly, the church is here to pray with you and for you that that sin might be forgiven. There's the invitation that God gives to all people. And those who respond in obedience to His invitation are those who can live this life with the hope of life eternal with God in heaven. And even though death may claim us and will claim us, unless Jesus comes back before that time, we will be those who will be resurrected unto life eternal with God. And so this evening, if you're subject to the invitation of Christ, we encourage you. When we stand and sing this song, we're doing that to encourage you to make your life right with God. And so if you need to respond, please come forward to Christ now while together we stand and sing.